Hello, everyone. I'm Xing Yang. I'm the lead architect of OpenSDS project. That's an open source project under Linux Foundation. Today, I'm going to talk about CNCF storage SIG. 大家好，我是杨欣，我是 OpenSDS 项目的首席架构师。 OpenSDS 是 Linux 基金会下的一个开源项目。今天呢，我会介绍一下 CNCF 存储兴趣组的一些情况。我会用英文来讲，欢迎大家随后用中文交流。So here's the agenda for today. So I will be talking about what is a CNCF SIG and what is CNCF storage SIG, how it interacts with other groups, and what we have been working on and how to get involved. So first I want to mention that the CNCF working group is transitioned into a SIG, and the purpose for that transition is that we want to scale contributions of the technical and user community so that we can help promote the CNCF mission, which is to make cloud native computing ubiquitous. And there's a lot of details of the CNCF SIG in that link over there. So the objectives of a CNCF SIG is to help promote a healthy and vibrant project ecosystem, find out what are the gaps in the CNCF project portfolio, maybe try to fill those gaps, educate and inform users, and also try to help project to become mature. And also CNCF SIG want to get community to be engaged so that there will be more people contribute to TOC and reduce project workload on the TOC. And most importantly, the SIG should be vendor neutral. So SIG is responsible for project handling that include documenting what is available under the project landscape, perform health checks, the projects that are in the area, and trying to figure out, are there any other projects that are not in CNCF, but maybe they are good candidates, and maybe try to attract them to join. And also, every CNCF project that got accepted into CNCF will be assigned to one SIG by the TOC. And CNCF SIG also help educate end users by providing white papers, presentations, and so on. And information needs to be research-based. And also collect information from end users, find out what they need, what are the pain points, and compile those information into some useful reports. And also get the community engaged. All the communication should be in public space, so public meetings and public mailing list. That's the way to communicate with the community. And the SIG should act as the trusted expert advisor to the TOC, so review the project and provide some feedback to TOC, help them make decisions. So what is a CNCF storage SIG? CNCF storage SIG's mission is to enable widespread and successful storage of persistent state in cloud-native environment. So we need to provide valuable information to TOC and users. And also, we need to collaborate with other related projects and help the projects that are already in the space to be successful, trying to find out if there are any gaps and try to fill those gaps in the CNCF landscape. So the storage SIG covers storage systems and approaches used in cloud-native environment. Storage includes block stores, file systems, object stores, databases, and key-value stores. And we're trying to understand storage system attributes and look at all the different aspects of storage system and see how they affect those attributes. So this is documented in our CNCF storage landscape white paper. So the storage SIG has the TOC license, which who is Xiang Li. Alex and Quinton are co-chairs, and Saad, Sugu, and myself are tech leads. So storage system is critical because application needs to store state somewhere. So making a storage solution to be interoperable with applications will help promote portability. This is the CNCF cloud-native definition. Basically says the cloud-native technologies help organizations to run scalable applications in public, private, and hybrid cloud. And CNCF wants to create an ecosystem of open source vendor-neutral projects so that will help them achieve the goal of making cloud-native computing ubiquitous. And the goal of storage in CNCF is to enable a thriving storage ecosystem that is vendor and platform neutral and interoperable for applications, so that will help drive the CNCF's mission. So here are a list of projects that have presented at the storage working group or SIG community meetings. And projects want to do those presentations because they want to make aware that such a storage project is available in the space. And some projects, they want to donate the project to CNCF, so they want to get some feedback by presenting at the storage SIG first before they present it to the CNCF TOC. So here are a list of the storage projects currently under CNCF. Rook is the storage orchestrator for Kubernetes. It was accepted as a sandbox project. Now it's an incubation project. That was actually the first storage project accepted in CNCF. Minion is not really a standalone project in CNCF, but it's supported by Rook as an object store backend. And Vitas supports horizontal scaling of MySQL. That's accepted as an incubation project. ETCD, distributed key value store. You're all familiar with it because it's used by Kubernetes. So that was accepted as an incubation project. And TyKV, that is a distributed transactional key value database. It was accepted as a sandbox project recently. It just became an incubation project. And also OpenEBS provides containerized block storage for containers. That was accepted as a sandbox project very recently. So interface with other groups. CNCF storage SIG. Interact with Kubernetes storage SIG, CSI, the apps SIG, Kubernetes service catalog SIG, and CNCF security SIG. So there could be more that are not listed here. So Kubernetes storage SIG is focusing on Kubernetes specific storage abstractions, interfaces, and how to implement them, and the features owned by the Kubernetes storage SIG include persistent volumes, volume snapshots, CSI drivers, and so on. So I think there are a lot of confusions on how is a CNCF storage SIG different from Kubernetes SIG. So yeah, so they are just working with each other. There are individuals working in both groups, but the CNCF 3SIG, the main purpose is to help the TOC to scale review projects in CNCF and so on. So I just want to pause here and see if there's any questions on the difference between Kubernetes 3SIG and CNCF 3SIG. Is it clear? Okay. Yes.
What's the difference between the virtualization storage stack with the Kubernetes storage stack from the IOPS point of view? So do you have a picture to help us quickly understand?
I think there is a picture later on, actually, that shows the data path. Maybe look at that when we get you there.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
Okay, thanks. Okay, so and then we are also interacting with the CSI. CSI defines the industry standard container storage interface so that storage vendor can just develop one plugin and have it work across a number of container orchestration systems. And also we interact with the Apps 6. CNCF AppSig that's not fully formed yet, but once that's formed, we'll be collaborating with them. And Kubernetes AppSig, so they have done some work on Kubernetes apps, how Kubernetes apps are using storage. And Kubernetes service, CatalogSig, they enable database services provided by cloud providers to be available in Kubernetes environment. So, and then also we work with the CNCF SecuritySig. SecuritySig, they are focusing on cloud native security. So what we have been working on? So we help TOC review new or existing storage projects in CNCF, and we created a storage landscape white paper, and we also created a storage survey for CNCF end users. So in the white paper, we focusing on the definitions and terminologies of storage systems. So we look at the attributes of storage systems and look at the different layers in the storage solution and see how they're impacting the attributes of a storage system. And also also look at the different data access interfaces and also the management interfaces of container orchestration systems. So these are the white paper authors. So inside a storage solution, you will have different interfaces and have many different layers of functionality, and they all have different impact on storage system attributes, including availability, scalability, performance, consistency, and durability. So availability refers to the ability to have access to data after some failure condition. So whether the storage system provided redundancy, data protection, whether it can fail over, those all affect availability. And scalability can be measured by different criteria that including whether it can scale by the number of clients, number of operations, number of components, and the throughput. And performance is measured by latency, throughput, number of operations. Consistency measures whether you can access to the correct data after commit, and then whether there is a delay between the time you access the data and the time of the commit determines the how consistent it is. Whether it is a, if there is no delay, then that's a strong consistency. If there is delay, then that's called eventual consistency. And durability, that is affected by whether the storage system provides data protection or redundancy. So storage system can be, it can be deployed as a hardware solution in a data center, but that could limit its portability. It can also be deployed as a software component on commodity hardware. And it can also be provided by public cloud providers. There are different storage layers. Orchestrator, host, operating systems, topology, data protection services, physical layer. So a hypervisor can provide access to resources. So instead of direct access, it can provide some mapping, some resource management, pooling, but that could increase the access overhead. And storage topology, so it can be centralized or distributed or sharded or hyperconverged. So those all have impact on the attributes like availability, scalability, performance, and consistency. And storage system could have some built-in data protection properties. They may use technologies such as RAID, erasure coding, replicas, and that could also affect the storage system's overall attributes. And also, there could be additional data services on top of the core storage functionalities, like replication, snapshots, and clones. Those could also impact the availability, durability, and performance. And storage also needs to persist the data somewhere on a physical layer, usually it's non-volatile. So that will also affect the overall durability and performance. So there are different data access interfaces. So workloads can consume storage using different data access interfaces. So here we categorize them into two, volumes and API. And volumes here refer to block file systems, jar file systems. And those are supported by the container orchestration systems such as Kubernetes. Kubernetes support two volume modes. It's either a file system or raw block mode. And the file system mode actually can be backed by either file system or block storage underneath. And this, the second category is called, we call it API, but that includes object stores, key value stores, and databases. So this table, this is based on some generally accepted attributes and measurements for block, file system, and the object store. So usually, block storage is suited for the use case where you require high availability, low latency performance, and good throughput for individual workloads. And it may not be good if you want to do capacity scaling, you want to share data with multiple workloads simultaneously. And file system is good for sharing data with multiple workloads simultaneously. And then it may not be good if you require strong file locking. And the object store is good for high availability. It supports large capacities. It's very durable. You can share data with multiple workloads simultaneously. It can also provide optimized throughput for parallelized workloads, but it could be slow in performance. And this is another generally accepted attributes and measurement table. This is for local, remote, and distributed storage. So in terms of availability, usually if it's a local, then well, that will be limited by your local resources. And remote, that could be limited by the single point of failure. And if it is distributed, then you may be able to achieve high availability. But of course, you added more complexity to it as well. And for scalability, also there are differences, but for local, it's limited by your local architecture, and for remote, you are limited by your monolithic architecture. If it's distributed, then you can scale easily. And for consistency, you can achieve consistency for whether it's local, remote, and distributed. You can achieve consistency, but for distributed, it's just harder because you need to implement it right. Durability, so that also for local, it's also limited by your local resources and the similar to this other attributes, right? So, but if it's distributed, then you have additional system to provide additional durability. If one system fails, you can use this other system. And performance, similarly for the local, limited by local components and the remote, then you will, it's going through the network, so it will be affected by the network. And if it's if you scale it, then you would have a additional performance because of the scalability. But if it's for distributed, of course, you always would have this added complexity. So this shows the orchestration and management interface. So I mentioned earlier that the workloads consume storage through a data access interface. And then here in the middle, we have this darker green control plane interface here that refers to the storage interface supported by container orchestration systems. So that includes CSI, which we mentioned earlier, and Docker volume driver interface, Flex volume, and Kubernetes native volume driver interface. So now in Kubernetes, we are all moving towards CSI. And the storage system can interact with the container orchestration system in two ways. As shown here, it can support the control plane interface directly, or it can go through this framework layer to communicate. So we did a survey. We created the survey, we sent it to the end users, just we have not got the results back yet, but I just want to show you this. This is a sample of a question that we are asking. So here we ask the end users to rank the attributes of storage systems based on how important they are when they make decisions on which storage system to choose from. So we listed availability, scalability, performance, consistency, durability, cost, ease of use, and they can also add anything that is not already listed here. So how to get involved? So we have this CNCF Storage Sig community meeting. It happens twice a month. So you see the meeting link there. So you are welcome to join the meeting. And we have a new repo under CNCF. After the Sig is created, there is this new repo. So you can find additional information there. And there's a public mailing list. You can join the mailing list to get more information. Okay. So what are we going to do next? So we need to get some feedback from end users and also from the audience like you. You know, what do you want to see from this SIG next? So we have the survey. There's a link there. I just showed you one page. So we are waiting to get feedback from end users. Then we will compile those results. And we want to do some case studies on how storage is used in the real world. And we want to write some papers to help end user understand different attributes of the storage systems. So we are thinking about looking at the performance and availability redundancy aspect first, trying to find some tools that can be used by the end users. So that's it, that's all I have. Any questions? So someone asked a question earlier, is that, I forgot who. Okay, maybe he left, okay. All right, any questions? Yes? Yeah, okay.
是这样，对于那个 cloud provider 来说的话、CSI 我们遇到一个问题是，那个我在 cloud provider 上很多那个存储都是 block storage， 但是我们希望给那个给 container 呈现的是一个 file system interface， 所以 CSI 现在的 raw block 和 volume 的 raw block 和那个 file system， 它在那个就因为 cloud provider 一般会基于 VM 去做那个做 container 嘛，这个大家都理解一下。然后那个，CSI 现在两种模式的话，都会把 block 的话是直接就 attach 到 host 上，然后 file system 呢会 mount 到 host 上，然后再由那个 container runtime 给 pass 到那个 container 那个 pass 到那个 VM 里边去。但这样对于那个一个基于 block 的 file system 来说的话，它会在 host 上和 guest 上同时 mount 两次。我们在那个 CSI 以前提过一个issue说这个事情，但是后来这个也没有推下去了。我想问一下 CSI 方面，这个对这个方面会有什么改动吗？
哦，这个我好像没有听说过这个 issue。
当时是我们跟那个跟 Red Hat 人一起下，他们做一个 virtualnet 那个东西。
哦，好像没有听到过讨论这个。你有没有什么 issue？ 你可以待会儿给我看一下。
行，我找一下这个 issue 吧。
哎，好的好的，但像这种可能我估计要推的话，可能会你要有很就是说很强的那种 use case， 要说得很清楚，这样才有可能，要不然可能就会比较困难，所以看一下你那个是怎么写的，好吧。 Any other questions? Yes.
你好，我们这边比较关注于镜像的存储，因为我是蚂蚁金服的嘛，因为我们这边有大规模的镜像在推的时候，镜像拉取会非常影响容器的扩缩容，就 pod 的扩缩容。但是在镜像的时候，除了预热这种方式，有没有更好的对镜像的对存储做一些优化的就方案？
就是 image 是吧？
对 image。
image 存储 ，image 存储，对这方面还真的没有。我还没有看见过有什么方案，一般就是你用的时候他会去把它 download 下来，但是没有什么说，
但是在大批量的扩容的时候，这个整个 整个数据中心的流量全是在镜像上
面。你这是扩容的时候出现的才会有需要，还是
还有校不调度的时候也会有？因为你不可能所有的镜像在所有的机器上都有，对不对？所以在这些pod 整个 pod 生命周期呢，第一步就拉镜像。那其实拉镜像的话，其实是非常慢的。那我们可能对一些 job 类的任务目标可能是在秒级或者是几百毫秒级把这个 pod 给起来，那镜像其实也是一部分了。所以看看就是有没有这种不需要拉镜像的这种方案做一些存储，因为现在的 CSI 里面它已经文件系统类似于就作为文件类似于一个用户态的文件系统或者是一个设备直接挂上去，而不需要去拉到本地。
但你这个是，所以你的这种镜像你都是要先把它放到一个什么，放到一个 PV 里吗？还是你是怎么样的用法？因为就是你拉下来以后是在 local 用呢，还是说你要先把它存在一个什么 persistent volume 上，你然后再用，还是怎么用法？
就看看社区有没有这种对镜像这块有没有加速的一个方案，或者是想法，或者是讨论组去做这个方面的事。
这个没有，就是你要是有什么想法，其实可以提出来，可以提一个 issue， 然后可以到那个CSI。就这个其实也 CSI 是，但是就是说你这个在 Kubernetes 也需要嘛，所以说你可能也要到那个 Kubernetes 的那个社区里也要提一下。
对，因为我们是。因为蚂蚁和阿里内部在镜像是有优化的，只是说看看社区有没有，就像一起。
那你们要是内部已经有这种的话，其实就说你可以，比如说你把你那部分要是开源的话，这也是一个选择，对吧？你那看就是说你合不合适把那部分开源，然后说看能不能把它，就是或者你要是有一些什么想法嘛，你可以。
对，我只是想看看社区
有。不是有这种啊，有些时候就是别人比如说在自己公司里做了一个什么东西，对吧？社区没有的，然后他可以把这推到，是有这种可能吗？但因为没有听说过这方面有什么，我没有听说有人做这个。如果已经有的话，当然你就可以直接用了，但是没有嘛，那你们可以就是根据你们做的，你也不一定是完全把它都推荐，但就是你觉得什么比较合适可以推荐，其实你可以去提这个 issue。 你觉得
可以。你好，我之前做过一些 volume driver 的一些开发，然后就是因为我们之前用的主要是一些对大数据的一些应用，然后他们又不喜欢用分布式存储，所以我们只能用 local volume。那用 local volume 的话，它的好处是那个性能可能好一点，那它的缺点可能就是因为我们在你要去对它创建一个磁盘，然后要去格式化，然后把它分配给那个 pod， 那这个里边遇到一个非常大的问题，就是它格式化的时间是非常慢的。比如你创建一个好几 T 的盘，然后格式化，然后这时候一直 creating 不出来，然后就会 mount 超时之类的过程，然后就会非常痛苦。这个反而就成了我们最后 pod 创建过程的瓶颈。这个是第一个问题。然后第二个问题就是，在我们开发一些 driver 的过程中，然后会有一些 volume 的状态是需要去持久化的，比如说这个 volume 可能正在 GC 或者正在 deleting， 或者是重复创建之类的一些过程，然后我们又不好把这些状态保存在 etcd 或者什么 pv 或者 annotation 之类的地方，因为它理论上从模型上来讲它不属于这个 pv， 而是属于一个 driver 的一个状态，但是我们没有一个好的地方去存，因为如果存在本地的话，然后又会遇到一些一致性的问题，所以我们只能临时去搭一个 file system， 或者去搭一个类似于一个数据库去存，这样又会显得非常的冗余，所以我想知道社区有没有这两个问题的解决方案，谢谢。
这就是第二个的话，我是听有别人也提过这样的问题，就是说不只是这种问题，就是类似的，有些时候 driver 它需要存一些东西，但是因为就说 Kubernetes 如果没有存的话，你就得存在自己的，但这个一直就没有一个什么，就是虽然有人提过，但一直就是说没有一个很好的解决方案，因为就是基本上现在都还是说让 driver 自己来解决，除非就是说比如说你有这样的 use case， 然后其他的人有这样的 use case， 就是很强的这种 use case， 然后可以想一想怎么样用一个统一的方法去解决。第一个问题是那个什么格式化时间长，你们有没有用过什么那种networks storage 呢？有没有试过那种呢？
因为主要是一些大数据或者数据库之类的应用，它不太、
哦、
对客户不太接受，那他不太接受 CNCF 啊或者之类的这种分布式存储、
哦，
因为会影响他们的应用性能。
哦、
他们只接受 local volume， 但是 local volume 的话，当你一旦去做扩容或者之类的或者扩展节点，然后它的 mount 时间就会非常的久。
是这个local volume 是好像是很多人对这个有要求，但是现在还有很多地方需要改进，这个也还没有听说实际上有什么比较好的解决方法。
OK，
所以你可以
谢谢
对，我就说你要可以去多提一下，比如说提的人多了，也可能就会，或者你要些什么比较好的那个建议，可以怎么样去优化也可以，因为现在那个 local volume 现在有，哦，说时间到了，行，
谢谢，
行，好的。